A very good morning to all of you. Which of the almost I think all the railways are representing Sundar?
Yes sir, most of the railways.
I think this is one of the richest in terms of numbers of the participation.
Exactly sir, we have been having almost 200-250 participants in everyday session sir.
That's very great. This is kind of like a turnaround presentations in terms of timetable which the director sir has made. I think this is pulling lot of listeners elsewhere from all the railways. Good morning to all of you. I think everyone and your family is well and safe.
I unmuted sir. I unmuted all the participants, they can speak to.
Good morning sir.
Morning sir.
Good morning sir.
Morning sir.
Morning sir.
Sir, please unmute sir. Please unmute to your audio.
Yeah. Good morning to all of you. I think there are senior level officers also taking part in this presentation. Happy to know about you. Today's topic given to me is regarding pension rules and pension matters. Be allowed to share the presentations. Is it visible to all of you?
Yes, sir. Visible, sir.
Okay. Thanks. So, coming to this pension matters of Indian Railways, this is one of the subjects which is always it remains a very crucial area where there are a lot of issues there is a pension settlement related issues. There are a lot of contention which goes around in order to finalize one of the cases of pension. All the railways, I feel that must be having a lot of problems related to the dependents and then issues related to multiple wives. With regard to finalization of the pension cases. So this presentation quickly tries to help all the background informations on the pension rules. So that at the end, if there is any case specifics are there, we can discuss about it. I have also brought in one or two cases of the case studies which we have recently faced in the South Central Railways. So everyone knows that the entire pension rule is covered under Indian Railway Railway Service Pensioners Rule of 1993. So as such, in the Indian Railways, the pension scheme was introduced with the effect from 1/1/1964. Right, all the railway employees who are in service as on 1/1/1986 and did not opt to be governed by the State Railway Provident Fund, that is a contributory system kind of like a pension, when those employees who are not covered under it and those employees who are appointed on or after 1/1/2004, these people, except these people, everyone else will be covered under the RSP or 1993. Pensionary benefits are admissible to those employees who retires, resign, died while in service. Briefly, there are lot of types of pension under this system. I have categorized in terms of and put it in a tabular column for a better understanding. The first type and the foremost or common type of pension is superannuation pension. As you all know that a person who is completing his service, as the case may be, whether it is 60 or 65, case of teaching staffs or the doctors, they are coming under the definition of the superannuation pension. So all the pensions related, rules are applicable to them in terms of this superannuation pension. Then the second type of pension is voluntary retirement pension. This is applicable to an employee who completes 20 years of qualifying service subjected to the 3 months notice period that he put in. It's in case where an employee requests the competent authority that this 3 months notice period to be waived, then the pension or the settlement will be processed. Everything will be paid except the portion of the commutation. Because we do not know at this point in juncture that after we are until the completion of the 3 months period, whether the employee would be live or otherwise. So that is for the sole reason that we withhold the commutation amount and then we process every other amount including the pension. Once after the completion of the 3 months notice period is over or the 3 months period is over, then the commutation amount is released in favor of this employee. Right. So this is one such important area in case of the voluntary retirement. One has to look into this that you have to ensure whether the VR applied employee is requesting for the waiver period or not. Then comes pension for invalidation pension. These are all applicable to all the employees who are found to be medically unfit. That is called as medically unfit and those status of the unfit, medically unfit, will have to be certified by the railway medical authorities. That they would be eligible for this invalid pension. The fourth type of pension is called as compulsory retirement pension. This is applicable to those railway employees whose services are found to be not desirable in the interest of administration of the public, those people can be retired compulsorily with pensionary benefit. Now, what is the catch here is that such an compulsorily retired employee, whether he is eligible for pension or gratuity or both, at what rate must be brought out by the disciplinary authority who is compulsorily retiring such employees, and such an amount should not be less than 2/3 of the pension and not more than full compensation pension or the gratuity or both as the case. So when an employee is retired, when the employee is retired compulsorily, the competent authority has to give a speaking order. In the same speaking order, he has to deliberate upon that what kind of pension or what amount of pension or a gratuity or both he is going to get it. The fifth type of pension is called as technical resignation pension. Everybody knows that a railway employee can technically resign and go and would get a pension in case if he completes 10 years of his service or more than 10 years of service in the railways. First, if he goes to PSU, railway PSU or the public sector undertaking or a central government as a part of deputation, and then from there he is applying for the permanent absorption in those organization, subjected to the fulfillment of or the completion of this period of 10 years or more, then such an employee is entitled for resignation pensions. Now, once he resigns and joins somewhere else, technical resignation, then such an employee will not be entitled for fairness relief in the organization where he has joined, provided that in that organization he is getting or his pay is fixed at the minimum of the pay in the scale. So if he gets minimum of the pay in the the other organization where he has resigned and joined, only in such case he is entitled for payment of this fairness relief. In this part of railway, there are vigilance cases there was a vigilance case where it was found that this TNS relief was also paid for those employees whose pay was not fixed in the organization at the minimum of the pay. So many many were advised, the vigilance has advised to, you know, give or hand over a minor penalty charge sheet. Many have given and many have, you know, dared to write a letter to vigilance that this is not worthy of giving or penalizing an employee who has, you know, proved his merit for, you know, for last 30 odd years of his service and got several awards for his contributions towards the duty. So one such this is one such area, important area, when the pension and settlement section process the file, they have to, you know, take care of this. Whenever, wherever you process the, you know, additional payments or the DNS, you need to have a self-check on these aspects. The employees who joined in any PSUs through open market after 10 years of qualifying service in the railways are also eligible to get this pension and the pensionary benefits, subjected to the fulfillment of he process this, you know, joining the PSUs through the proper channel in the right place. The sixth type of pension is death pension, that is death while in service. Any employee, whether temporary or permanent, dies while in the service, his or her spouse is eligible for family pension, which is a normal family pension like any other superannuation pension, and such other benefits as per the rules allow. The seventh type of pension is called as SFP, that is secondary family pension or dependent family pension. This is applicable to the wards of the employees or the pensioners where both the railway employee or the family pensioner are not alike. In this case, son up to age of 25 years, unmarried daughters, divorced and widowed daughters, that is, were divorced, widowed prior to the death of either of the parents, prior to the death of either of the parents, either railway employee or the wife, the surviving wife, got the family pension. Before that, prior to the death of them, they should have become either divorced or widowed. Only in such cases, they are allowed for secondary family. Up to what period? Up till the time of new marriage, subjected to not only that, prior to the death should be, you know, that criteria should be met, and up to remarriage, there is one another reason that it is also subjected to monthly income less than the minimum of the pension, right? Then only they become eligible for this secondary family. Sons even after 25 years of age has, I mean, is also entitled for secondary family pension if they are physically or mentally challenged and not in a position to earn, and which has to be also certified by the railway workers. Only meeting these two criteria, son and daughter who are, you know, disabled or mentally challenged, will become eligible for the secondary family. Most of, all the pensions, the calculation of which are primarily dependent on the qualifying service of an employee at the time of, you know, superannuation or the death or voluntary retirement, are becoming entitled for this, you know, pension. All these criteria are based on how much of the qualifying service an employee has got. So, extraordinary leave can also be considered for counting the qualifying service purpose if it is supported by the medical support and approved by the company. Break in service is not counted for the qualifying service except when it is regularized as a period of time. So I'll come briefly that what are the eligibility criteria for the calculation of qualifying services. Everyone knows in the railways that an employee who renders minimum of 10 years of qualifying service becomes entitled for pensionary benefit if he retires from the service. So minimum period of 10 years is the yardstick for the eligibility for meriting the eligibility of the pension. RBI 70-2019 has a master circular on this qualifying service for the pension purposes. If the net qualifying service of an employee is 10 or more than 10 years in formal retirement and 20 years in case of voluntary retirement, are eligible for full pension subjected to the maximum of 33 years of net qualifying service. Now, what are the period are not counted for or not considered for calculation of this qualifying service? The first one is the absent period not covered by any of the medical certificate, removal or dismissal from service. The third one, resignation from service, period of unauthorized absence, foreign service in respect of which the foreign employer or the railway servant has not paid the foreign service contribution unless the payment specifically made by the President of India. In such case, also the period of the period will not be considered as a qualifying service since he or the foreign employer has not paid the foreign service contribution towards his depreciation. And the period of Dies non is a day which cannot be treated as a QP for any purposes, but it does not constitute a break in service. This period to be not to be considered, I think I am just slightly confusing. One, break in service not counted for qualifying service except when it is regularized as a Dies non. So Dies non period which is regularized can be considered for the qualifying service. Service rendered for which salary paid from contingencies like payment to casual laborers will not be considered as a part of qualifying service. However, an ex-India leave can be considered for qualifying service if it is sanctioned by the competent authority. So, the items which are in the allowable bands are not prepared for qualifying service. The linkage of full pension with 33 years of qualifying service, that criteria of linking of 33 years has been dispensed or dealing with the effect from 1-1-2006, and 50% of the emolument or the last 10 months average pay, whichever is beneficial for an employee, is payable after 10 or 20 years as mentioned above, as you know, for the pension purpose. So whatever is beneficial, whether it is 50% of the emolument or the last 10 months average pay, whichever is beneficial to an employee, becomes a yardstick for calculation. Regarding this, eligibility of pension, board letter of 2000 also brings out non-inclusion parameters that the pension or qualifying service shall count from the date of first appointment, provided the group B services prior to 17 April 1950, they have been engaged. Their service rendered before attaining the age of 16 years will not be considered as, or will not be countable for the purpose of calculation of the qualifying service. And in case of railway servant not covered under the above, 17 April 1950 before, they have not, if they have been engaged after this period, then the service rendered before attaining the age of 18 years shall not count. One such, rule which I have found and found relevant to charity. A qualifying service of, if suppose I said that 10 years and more than 10 years will become eligible for pension, and then qualifying service will be treated or calculated according to that. But a qualifying service of 9 years and 9 months and above, at the time of retirement, shall be treated as 10 years of service for the purpose of pension and death or retirement pension. Right? This is one such rule in Indian Railways. When there is a pension scheme in autonomous body, the employee can opt for count of service rendered in railways. Say for example, when a railway employee goes to an autonomous body, central or central autonomous body, which is also having a similar structure of, pension rules, or pensionable, pensionable dispensation, then such employee can opt his earlier services to be counted for the purpose of pension. Then a person initially appointed on a contract basis and subsequently taken in the same capacity without break in service can also be counted for qualifying service. He has to be absorbed. He has to be absorbed from the contract basis to the permanent basis on the same capacity. In such case, this period can also be considered. And counting of military services rendered before joining the service can also be considered. This is in terms of Relevant Letter 7-12-2004. There are few exceptions to this calculation of qualifying service. When a casual labor, a casual labor who has rendered his service on or after 27-8-1968, his 50% of the service can also be counted for calculation of qualifying service. Period spent on training or apprentice prior to regular appointment will also count for this qualifying service and qualifying service calculation. Substitute service followed by regularization, 120 days needs to be deducted, arrive at the qualifying service. Case of promotions or TAD case. Right? What if happens if there is an interruption in the services in which there is no specific instructions in contrary is being available in the service book? What happens to that period? If the period interruption between the two spells of if it is condoned by the competent authority, then such a period should be considered for calculation of the net qualifying service. It is not applicable, however, in case of resignation, removal, dismissal, and for participation in strike. All these circumstances, the interruption of the services will not be taken into the qualifying service. What happens to the counting of suspension period? Whether to incorporate the period of period under the suspension in qualifying service or other things. So the rule says that the charges are not finally. The charges are not proved. The suspension period is counted for qualifying service, and the absence will be treated either as on duty or leave duty. And this also the disciplinary authority has to, in his final speaking order, has to clearly and specifically has to bring out that how to be treated all those period of suspension. So this is very important for all the disciplinary authority. In case if you are placing an employee under suspension, please keep in mind that the disciplinary authority has, at the time of issuing the speaking order, has to elicit very clearly this aspect. Counting of the service spent on leave. All leave granted during the service for which leave salary is payable can be counted for qualifying service, including extraordinary leave sanctioned on medical ground with certificate. This part I have already, a couple of slides back, I have covered. What happens to the past service on somebody's reinstatement? Right? A person, an employee, has been dismissed or removed or compulsorily retired, but he has appealed either, to the appellant authority or through the court and he being reinstated. What happens to the service rendered by him in the past? So the rule says that the railway servant who is dismissed, removed or compulsorily retired from service, but he is reinstated on appeal review, then the past service rendered by the railway employee will have to be counted for qualifying service. Then what happens during the part of the period where he was appealing? This rule says that the period of service from dismissal, removal or CR and up to the date of reinstatement and the period of suspension will not count as a qualifying service unless it is regularized as duty or leave by a specific order of the authority which passed the order of reinstatement. So this is also equally very very important that when you process when you process an employee's pension, you need to go through his SR that whether this employee was at any point in time was either removed, dismissed and compulsorily retired and has come back as you know part of reinstatement was done or not. That you need to see, and you need to also see the disciplinary authority order that whether this period has to be counted or not. This aspect has to be looked into by the settlement section or by the pension you know sanctioning section and the authority. When an employee superannuates, there are a lot of payments that we do make. In addition to the pension, like commutation, service gratuity, CGS, PF, VLI, ECRG, and the other stuffs. So I have, you know, for briefly, I have made it in the table column that under which of the circumstances, what has to be paid. This is, since it is very closely associated with pension, this I thought that I should be doing this. The rule defines that who are entitled for the family pensions. Everybody knows it, that for the, you know, the employee himself on superannuation, and after the death, his you know, legally wedded wife, then comes to the son and daughter, and then disabled the son and daughter, then comes to the you know the widowed widowed or widowed daughter or widowed and widowed unmarried, one more thing, divorced daughter. So all these things will come in and kind of like an order. In addition to that, that you know parents who are wholly dependent on that. Pensioners at the time of you know before the death of the railway employee. So these all are you know definitions or the entitlement of the members who will become eligible for pensions. Calculation of the pensions, everybody knows it. Just want to you know revisit. It is based on net qualifying service. If the net qualifying service of an employee is 33 years, say for example the last basic including the GP 72,100, the pension would be half of that. You know, pension would be half of that. That becomes enhanced family pension, and the normal family pension once after the completion of the enhanced family pension period, it becomes to be you know capped at 30% of that last basic plus GP. The effect from 1/1/2006 onwards, prorata pension as per net qualifying service has been dispensed. I said earlier that 50% of the last pay or last 10 months average pay will be considered, whichever is more. The commutation, as part of the commutation, is paid at the rate of 40% of the pension. You have a commutation factors with respect to the age at which an employee is retiring. So the age factor into 12 into 40% of pension will become one's commutation. I said that for the voluntary retired employees who have requested for waiver of 3 months period, commutation should not be paid up till the completion of the 3 months period. Regarding the quantum of the pension, everybody knows that the minimum pension payable as on today is 9,000 rupees, wherein the maximum pension allowed for any level of railway employee, the maximum pension allowed is 1,12,500 rupees. All cases except cabinet secretary rank or cabinet secretary, where it is 1.25 rupees. maximum pensioners, maximum pension amount in terms of doctors is 1,18,750. This is the place where you will find a lot of overpayment done by the banks. Recently, we have done an analysis for most of the railways, and we have written to even railway board also, with a copy to the concerned railways PFAs, duly bringing out that for what of the BPOs this overpayment was done. So in case of, there are a lot of overpayment was done in case of several other employees, either in case of wrong dates picked by the banks, or in this case of doctors also, there are a lot of overpayment. This we have deducted recently and then sent to the concerned railways. So one has to look into that, the maximum pension of pensioners as well as doctors. In case if somebody is not completing 10 years, they become ineligible to get any of the pensions. They are anybody, an employee or family, but they are entitled for an amount called service gratuity towards the recognition of the service that he has rendered but could not complete the 10 years service period. So they will be paid a service gratuity in lieu of pension at the rate of half month's emolument, that is basic plus DA, for each of the half year of the qualifying service, subject to a maximum of 2 years. This is a calculation that one does for arriving at the service gratuity. This service gratuity also is not applicable or admissible if the qualifying service of an employee is less than 5 years, in which case they would be coming under the WC Act. The service gratuity payable will not be exceeding 16 and a half times of the basic plus, subjected to the maximum of 20 lakhs. Then we also pay the time of retirement. We do pay retirement or death gratuity. For that, a minimum of 5 years qualifying period is very much mandatory. And eligibility to receive service gratuity or pension is essential for this one time person. And this is also to be calculated. Maximum is 16 and a half times of basic plus DA, subjected to the maximum amount of 20 lakhs. Death gratuity in the event of death of an employee while in service is to be calculated in the manner it is presented in the table. There are definitions for the family, for the purpose of, definition of a family for the payment of gratuity, and which should be in order for considering the death gratuity or the retirement gratuity. In case of, family, wife or wives, including initially separated wife or wives, in the case of male railway servant, husband, including initially separated, in case of female railway servant, sons including stepsons and adopted sons, unmarried daughters including stepdaughters and adopted daughters, widowed daughters including stepdaughters and adopted daughters, then other aspect on the other box, there is a father, mother, brother below the age of 18 years including stepbrothers, unmarried sisters and widow sisters, then married daughters, children of predeceased son. Now how this payment is made? The gratuity purpose. For death gratuity, the gratuity payable to the persons on whom the right to receive the gratuity is confirmed by the railway servant by making a nomination. So there must be a nomination for allowing this gratuity payment. There must be a nomination. If no nomination was executed or finding place, then it is payable for 1 to 5 in an equal share. If the 1 to 5 is not there, then the 6th to 11th will be paid in an equal share. This is the spread or the payment way of death gratuities. If no eligible members, family members are available and if it is to be payable or if it is to pay to the minor children of the deceased employee, then it is payable to the guardian, who is, you know, officially being brought in. The railway servant shall, on his initial confirmation, make a nomination conferring one or more persons the right to receive this instrument. This must be made available, this instrument. In case it is not available, the proportion in which it has to go was discussed just now. An employee and a railway pensioner who has completed 80 years and above are entitled for getting additional quantum on his basic. If anyone completed his age, anyone completed 8 years of age would get 20% additional quantum on his basic. Similarly, for 85, 90, 95, 100, the rate at which additional quantum has to be. Now, in this aspect also, one would see a lot of overpayment made by the banks. Instead of the date of birth of the family pensioner, they would take the date of birth of the railway employee who has deceased. So the age is quickened, payment is made erroneously. These are all the aspects when we go to the banks or when we take out the PPO and then scrutinize it, we need to find this aspect. Everyone knows that a railway employee or the member of family of the railway employee is entitled for enhanced family pension. In the event of death while in service, spouse is entitled for enhanced family pension at the rate of 50% of the last pay, right? Up till 10 years from the date following the death of the employee. In case of service up to 7 years, then only normal family pension is allowed. After this 10 years period, the normal family pension of 30% rate will be. In normal retirement cases, suppose an employee that is other than death, in the normal retirement case, the railway employee in a normal course will be entitled for enhanced family pension up to the 7 years of his, up to 7 years from the date following the death subject to maximum of pensioners attaining the age of 67 years. So actually this death is not there. In a normal parlance, 7 years or 67 years, whichever is earlier, up to that period, the enhanced family pension is allowed. Thereafter, normal family pension. There are some of the case studies which we made, which I already told. Most of the rules or the basic have already been discussed. Two or three case studies I would want to discuss, which we have done. It's a case of sanction of death benefit. The pension came up to this railway. The brief history of the case is that an employee, while working in one of the departments, had expired in the year 2020 September. His wife, named P. Santamma, was also predeceased in the year 2002. Right? We received three claims from three different parties. The first claim was claimed to have been a second wife. She has applied for settlement benefits and pension as a second wife, mentioning that she got married with the deceased employee in the year 2013, for which there was no record available as an evidence with the administration. So no nomination, nothing was available. The genuineness of the claim of the lady was further verified and it was found that the marriage was registered to the AP sub-registers of marriages office, and the deceased employee had also executed a registered will in her name. Right? The lady subsequently, the lady was earlier widow in the year 2002 and was getting a dependent family pension of her father as dependent widow daughter upon the death of her mother, who was family pensioner at that time. She was getting secondary family pension from 2013 onwards. Right? She married in the year 2013. She was also getting secondary family pension from 2013 onwards. After 3 months of the sanction of secondary family pension, she got married to the above man in the year 2013, and she was continuously getting her sub-piece. The second claim was adopted son, aged 24 years, who has claimed settlement. Now his claim is turned down by the administration as per the rule of board that the adoption is valid only when the adopted child not completed the age of 15 years. Wherein in this case the adoption was done not before the age of 15 years but was after. So straight away the claim was disposed by the administration. Then there was third claim. That means the third claim was that daughter-in-law of the deceased employee has made a claim. So her claim was not valid as there was no provision made in the pension rule for sharing the death benefits in case of daughter-in-law. What was the conclusion made? That the legally wedded wife, second wife, will become eligible for receiving all the pensionary benefits including the family pension because she is legally wedded as available in the certificates of the AP sub-registered of marriage. Her secondary family pension as widow daughter has to be stopped immediately and recovery should be ensured for the period from 2013. So this we have written to the concerned bank disposing the second one. The claim of adopted son is not valid because the adoption itself is invalid as per the regular rules. Claim of daughter-in-law is not valid, there is no rule. The son of pre-deceased, the fourth claim was that the grandson also applied for the benefit. So son of the, grandson was also made ineligible as legally wedded second by his alive. This is one such case which we held in the recent time. There was one more case of pension case we did, wherein we found that eligibility under two pensions on dependent parents. Eligibility of two pensions to dependent parents. Now the rule is very, very clear. Case of eligibility of two pensions, that at the time of getting, one should be wholly dependent on the railway employer at the time of his death also. The rule is very, very clear. But while scrutinizing one of the case, an employee, in a case that an employee expired while in service and has no family except the widowed mother with him. Right? The situation is that at the time of the death of the employee, only widow mother was alive. The widow mother was already getting family pension as spouse upon death of her husband. Now a situation came whether she has to be she has to be eligible for, she is eligible for secondary family pension, that is the two pensions. As per the sanction by the executive, dependent family pension was authorized through PPO and sent to CPPC. Doubt arises by the CPPC that whether two pension is admissible for widow mother, because we did not know that she was getting another pension due to his demise of her husband. We did not know it, but CBPC brought the notice to us because payment was made in the same bank. So the rule position after school chasing, the rule position is that parents who were wholly dependent on the deceased government servant when he or she was alive will also to be, you know, entitled to the family pension with the effect from 1st January 1998. This is the OM dated 5th March 1998. Subjected to the fulfillment of other conditions prescribed in this regard of the two pensions. It is clarified in that guideline that the family pension will be admissible in these cases subjected to the following. Parents who were wholly dependent on the government servant when he or she was alive. The government servant has not left behind a widow, widower, eligible son or a daughter. The widow or divorced daughter who will have a prior claim to the family pension in the order indicated in the P, serial number P. So these both are categories, both are rule has to be tested for in order to make somebody eligible or otherwise. There are other reference letters for this kind of related cases that in the 1998 which I just now told, the parents who are wholly dependent on deceased government entitled for the family pension, then the family pension is admissible to a beneficiary in respect of one deceased employee or the pensioner is not to be counted as income for the purpose of determination of eligibility for another family pension which is admissible in connection with another deceased employee. So this is a case where if suppose both the employees are a government employee, one has died, both the parents have died, and the children, the surviving child or children have become eligible for two family pension. Now in this light of all this rule, the conclusion was made that in the instant case, the payment of dependent family pension to the widowed mother upon the death of the son who are having no eligible parties like spouse, children were, you know, examined in light of all these rules and she was made ineligible despite this rule of one deceased employee or a pensioner is not to be counted as income for the purpose of determination of eligibility for another family pension only on the sole reason that at the time of death of the son, she was not wholly dependent on the son. He was already getting a pension through his, you know, through her husband. So the pension was pension which she was receiving is not an it is an income which was considered. These two, three cases are there. Recently we dealt one more case also. One of the employee who has technically resigned, submitted his technical resignation and joined IRCTC, has subsequently retired, has approached this office to count his IRCTC period for the purpose of calculation of the pension or the, you know, qualifying service. This is not allowed as per the railway rules that at the time of absorption, permanent absorption into the means in terms of like in IRCTC, it was very categorical that for all the purposes the railway employee is considered to, you know, leave the organizations you know, permanently. So it was on a permanent discharge and that count only such an employee were allowed to go to and permanently absorb to IRCTC. On that count, this employee was informed that he is not eligible for inclusion of the period that was there with the IRCTC. I think most of the things I have covered, if there is anything left out, it can be, you know, discussed. Recently, Railway Board also came out on a clarification of this two pension ceiling limit also. The maximum pension which I have told has been earmarked or has been capped at that rate only two pensions shall be allowed, beyond which is not allowed. So 1.16 or whatever I have said, that becomes a ceiling point for two pension is allowed as per the rules. I end my presentation here. In case of any doubt or anything, try my best to.
Yeah, I'm going to unmute, sir. I'm going to unmute all the participants.
Yes.
Yeah, participants, you can ask.
Good afternoon, sir. I have a query.
अरे वो तो पहले ही लड़का
right now on deputation. I have one complaint regarding one lady. She is getting pension from Rajasthan government. That is very nominal pension. That is not her husband pension. That is widow pension, which is given by government of Rajasthan to her. And subsequently, she is getting family pension as a widow daughter from the railways.
Okay.
So, is there any anomaly, whether she can get that pension or she is eligible for getting family pension? Because there is no reply as such as received from Rajasthan government regarding this.
I think the pension is very unique and uniform, that a person is allowed for only one pension.
But sir, that is hardly nominal pension. So for that, because as of now, I have not received any reply from the Rajasthan government whether is admissible from their side or not, because from the railway everything is clear, all the papers are clear, she is getting pension from
this. How much is she getting?
From there, I think so it is 1400 or 1500 from there, monthly.
Okay, this is a very unique case of state and center.
Yeah, yes, sir. And as of now, even I have written Rajasthan government 4-5 letters from our railways. But till date, they have not replied and they have not commented on that. Ki whether it is admissible, they are allowing that. Because they, I think so, we have written them that she is already getting a pension on place of a family pension as a widow daughter. But as of now, there is, and even I have written it to Railway Board also, but there is, in fact, still there is no reply from them.
From board also.
Yes. We have already talked, but this is absolutely a unique case from them also, because that is not a pension from her husband. That is the, we can say that, like 1400, 1500 as a widow persons, like the Rajasthan government is giving.
See that whether it is a, just see that whether it's a, it is dispersed in the name of pension or some kind of like an, there are some of the state government which gives not as a pension but as a consolatory, like some supporting amount.
Yes, it is something to support the widow lady. These of the. In Ajmer, Rajasthan government.
Just see that there are states like Tamil Nadu and all, they do give a certain kind of like.
So this is with the name of the pension, widow pension. for the ladies jinke koi, which are not getting any other benefit.
If it is in the name of the pension, as far as my understanding goes, that one is entitled for one pension. One pension only. Unless and until this two pension concept, which I have told, the normal is applicable for the son and daughter.
That's why I asked that.
Both the parents are working and then they divorced. In which case, only this two pension is allowed. As far as my understanding, there is no more than one pension from two sources to be allowed. Yet, I'll confirm this case. This is also a new case for me at state and state.
Okay.
Just leave your contact number in the chat.
Yes, sir.
We'll clarify, double clarify it, because I do not want to give you my views. Let's
yes.
Rule, as per the rule, whatever is.
Sir, I'll take your number and I'll discuss this from you, sir, personally.
Sure. Sure.
Thank you, sir. So nice of you.
Sir, please hear PPT is a two part, sir.
Just
a
minute.
Can reach
the call center.
Yeah, I'll do that.
Sir?
Hello.
Sir, Ravi Shankar Chakraborty. Yes. I'm Sir Ravi Shankar just speaking, sir. Sir, in case of family pension, one employee has retired from service, but she has two daughters, unmarried daughters.
Okay.
And whose name will be written in PPO?
Senior most by date of birth.
Senior most or date of birth?
Date of birth.
Okay, sir. And as illustration you have indicated, sir, pay means in 7 CTC?
Yeah.
Pay means here in under 7 CTC there is no great pay, only level.
No, this great pay concept I have made it from 6 CTC. You can take it the corollary of the 7th pay matrix.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Hello.
Sure, ma'am. Tell me.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir, see, my husband was working in traffic accounts Bangalore.
Okay.
And he expired in 2002.
Okay.
And I got the job only in 2004, January. On 4th, they gave the exam.
Okay.
Where they delayed for 2 years. And I was not eligible for taking my family pension now.
From when?
Of 2004, they gave the exam.
No. Your husband, you are saying that he expired in the year 2002.
Yeah.
Which month?
July.
So, from July. From July.
I was getting my family pension.
Okay.
But the compassion loan, they gave me the job.
Okay.
And 2004 only they gave me the job. In January 4th they gave me the exam. Why 4 days delay, sir? Why they want to make a delay for not getting the family pension? New pension scheme they put. See, from 2002 to 2004, why they want to make so much of delay? When I was going on, I was giving all the
documentation. Right. Hello? Am I audible to you?
Yeah.
Yeah, your point of worry is that on two count. One is that from July 2002 you started getting your pension.
Yeah.
Pension.
Yeah.
Up till which period you got, ma'am?
Up till the first 7 years. After the 7th PC, then I got for another 3 years.
Okay. When did you got your compassionate appointment absorption?
2004 February, sir. January 2004 they gave the exam.
January 2004?
They gave the exam.
They conducted the exam?
Yeah. Just 4 days of delay, I lose my pension. My family pension.
How come? You are now coming under NPS, isn't it?
Yeah.
You mean to say that I should have been in the...
pension scheme. I should be in the pension scheme.
Pension scheme.
Yeah.
The rule says that your entire exams and appointment, entire exams and finalization of the result, if it has been done prior to 1/1/2004, you have been allowed to join the railways after 1/1 or after 1/1/2004, in which case only, as of now, as per the you know, leave a PT as and as per the railway board rules, one is entitled for the previous like old pension schemes rules. Rest of the things, everything will be covered under new pension scheme.
Okay.
Your case is very, very unique that it is on the administrative side that asked, I mean, how many years they have took to give you compassionate appointment?
2 years, sir.
So, these are all administrative procedures. There are a lot of procedures which goes into since you apply for your compassionate appointment. There are a lot of things goes on from your department to submit to personal department. Then it goes to, you know...
then the headquarters is open, hopefully 2 or 3.
Goes to headquarters, gets, you know, DM's, DM's approval, your exams. You know, your exams...
No, it is delayed by the administration, sir, actually. I was going on telling even after opening headquarters, I called me for job, I said I am ready to go. But they did not give the application or examination anything. Why they made so much of delay? Still, they void the exam exactly 4 days before the jam and board, the why should they want to give the conduct exam? This is purposely, I think it has been done now, sir. I am very, actually, I am upset. For 2 years, I was just sitting at the home with my child, 7 years old, only getting the family pension.
Madam, your case is very genuine. You have been, you know, waited for 2 years. The exams, for whatever reasons, it was conducted after 1 month. For all the practical, you know, rules purposes, since your exams was conducted after 1 month, you will be coming under this this NPS.
Sir, why? This is administration delay, now, sir. Why should I should have to go?
You can represent to the DM of yourself, sir. For your grievance.
That's what I want to ask. Shall I give a grievance to my GM?
Just give a grievance. Let's see what works out for you in terms of application.
See, just because of 4 days delay and result was announced on 28 January and appointment was given on February 4th.
So I said rule-wise, the date of examination and the result.
Good afternoon, sir. I am Kannan from Southern Railway.
Yes, Kannan.
Sir, what was it? You were putting railway service for 10 years, then he joined to BHEL.
Okay.
After retiring there with BHEL, he claimed pension from railways for 10 years rendered, service rendered.
Okay.
Now, that person died. Whether he is eligible for getting the pension again from railways?
10 years he has completed in railways.
And so he got pension.
So he gets the railway pension.
Yeah, yes, sir.
Right, and he goes to rail and then he retires from there. And,
yes.
Is he getting pension there also?
No. There is no pension in BHEL.
Right, so he gets a railway pension.
Railway pension only.
Railway pension. Now, you say that his wife
is no more. Whether his wife is eligible for that?
The person is no more and wife is eligible. What rule says, pension rule says? Pension rule says that if anybody crosses 10 years or more, becomes eligible for pension and also the family pension.
Okay.
That is the pension rule.
Okay, so sir, see, eligible for family pension.
Yeah, in view of that rule, the widow becomes eligible. But the qualifying service, you need to calculate for those period up to which time.
Okay.
Hello, sir. One more question, sir.
Yes,
ma'am. See, I joined in 2004.
Okay.
As I told my husband, a passer, sir. Now I want to know whether I can give VR after this month. Because with Corona is so much. You said after 20 years of service only you can give VR, voluntary retirement. In my case, in compassion account, whether my service has been put up to 17 years.
Whose service is
my service?
Your service, no, ma'am.
Yeah.
Okay. NPS the NPS policy doesn't differentiate in terms of the old, like old pension.
Okay.
And you have to retire in order to get eligible to pension. Now the concept of old pension and the cap of 20 years is different from the rules of NPS. In NPS, you can resign or voluntarily retire at any point in time, but the pension or the amount of the pension you will be getting through the PFRDA or the annual
support. I won't be getting now.
What will you be getting is that the corpus that you have invested in the market by the pension fund managers and the interest which they have paid at the time of your application to the PR, that amount will be brought back, wherein 20% will go into your bank account and the remaining 80% choose the annuity service providers. There are 7 annuity service providers as of now approved by PFRDA. You have to choose any one of the annuity service providers, and in terms of the choice that which you make, whether you want a monthly pension, monthly annuity, or quarterly, or yearly, or even within that you want to cover your family, there are a lot of options available. So you need to choose this ASPs at the time of your, you know, 15 days before your application or your acceptance of PR. You need to apply to your TDO, and the PAO has to, you know, approve it, and it has to be taken to, you know, through the system to CREA.
Okay.
And then CREA will initiate the payment of 20% towards your, you know, your side proportion, and 80% will keep it with themselves, and you need to choose the ASPs the system to the TDO or by application form upon which then they will link the ASPs with you, where you have to enter into a formal agreement in terms of prices on how many years and these things. Then only such an ASP will give you the monthly annuity terms like a pension. It's not like a OSP.
Okay,
so,
thank you.
Sir, 1 second.
Sir, you told me that the pension after the age of 80 years, pensioner get 20% more or after the age of 80?
Sorry, you have missed, your voice got disconnected. Please come again.
Sir, there is a query, sir. Sir,
yes.
I want to know. Sir,
yeah, please.
An employee was appointed in the railway service.
Okay.
In the month of November 2003, as a TADK, and after 120 days, he got temporary status.
When he got temporary status?
In the month of February 2003, after 120
right.
days.
Right.
He got to TS in the month of February 2004. In
okay.
which scheme he will be treated?
He will be treated under the new pension scheme, because this 120 days period of the you know, preliminary period is not counted. It is from the date on which he is getting the temporary status only. This period will be counted for which of the pension scheme it is related.
Sir.
Yes.
Pensioner get at the age of 80, pensioner get 20% more, 25% more. The same rule is applicable for widower.
Yes, why not?
Widower,
widower also gets 50% process.
After the age of 80, more 20% more.
Yes.
Okay, sir. Thanks.
Afternoon, sir.
Hello.
Hello. सर आपने डाइसनॉन पीरियड के बारे में थोड़ा सा क्लियर करेंगे.
ओके राइट.
व्हाट टाइम सर जब अपन कैलकुलेट करते हैं ना, तो उस टाइम जब हम डाइसनॉन पीरियड
राइट सी एक्चुअली देयर आर गुड अमाउंट ऑफ कोर्ट प्रोसीडिंग्स ऑन द वर्डिक्स ऑन द डाइसनॉन. यू गूगल आउट दैट व्हाट इज टू बी ट्रीटेड एज डाइसनॉन. There are wonderful court judgments on this, even for railway employees. Now, what this period of Dyson on is that an employee who comes to office, right, and not found in office, after marking the attendance, an employee not found in the seat and you know, not working, but he or she placed her attendance. The competent authority can treat this as a period of placement, that it is an authorized absence from the place of seating, he or she is not found, and therefore this can be, this is an period of placement where the attendance will go and a warning letter will be issued, but this cannot be tantamount to equivalent to the break in service. There are
three, four, तो उसमें अगर एक सब्जेक्ट में तो उनको हम जैसे 7 दिन के लिए रोकते हैं, उसके बाद वापस एग्जाम लेते हैं और एग्जाम लेने के बाद उनको भेजते हैं। मान लीजिए एक से अधिक कई कोर्सेज कई सब्जेक्ट्स में अगर कोई फेल हो गया है बच्चा, है ना, तो उसको कई बार कोर्स रिपीट करना पड़ता है ना, क्योंकि एक से ज्यादा विषयों में फेल हुआ है तो उसको कोर्स रिपीट करना पड़ेगा। तो नेक्स्ट जो कोर्स है हो सकता है कि वेरी नेक्स्ट डे से हो, या हो सकता है एक दो महीने के बाद हो, या हो सकता है 6 महीने के बाद भी, है ना। तो क्योंकि हमारा जो ट्रेनिंग पीरियड होता है वो क्वालिफाइड सर्विस में ऐड होता है, है ना। यहाँ पर जब वो दोबारा सेकंड बार में आएगा उसका जो बीच का सारा पीरियड गया, मैं जितना समझ पाई हूँ पढ़ाने के हिसाब से और पढ़ने के हिसाब से, हो सकता है मैं सही हूँ या गलत हूँ सर, पर आपसे मतलब इसलिए समझना चाह रही हूँ क्योंकि मैंने जो पढ़ा है उसमें क्या है कि जो शुरू से पीरियड होता है उस पीरियड में ट्रेनिंग के दौरान हमने उनको स्टाइपेंड भी दिया है, है ना, उनको सारा कुछ पे किया है, लेकिन हम वहाँ से उनकी सर्विस क्वालिफाइंग में नहीं जोड़ते हैं उसको, मतलब वो पीरियड को उसको सर्विस बुक में एंट्री करनी पड़ती है डजन ऑफ पीरियड की। और जब वो सेकेंड टाइम सर्विस में जब मतलब वापस ट्रेनिंग के लिए ज्वाइन करते हैं वहाँ से उनका क्वालिफाइंग पीरियड अकाउंट होता है। अगर कंटिन्यूशन में है तो अलग है, पर कंटिन्यूशन में नहीं होता है तब भी ऐसी परिस्थितियाँ आती हैं।
रिगार्डिंग दिस somebody has joined in a training, right? The period of training is also to be treated as for the voting of the qualifying service.
Yes.
Now, you are saying that the person who has appeared for exam and he has failed in certain subjects and he has to be, he has to be appear for the paper and then training, second
training.
So, the course was made to be repeated, isn't it? But what I understand is that a person who has joined the railway in terms of training. Ma'am, you are not clear.
Your voice is not clear.
You are not clear, ma'am.
Sir, आपका mobile number जैसे दीजिएगा तो मैं ना आपसे personally उस पे मैं आपसे discuss कर लूँ.
Sure, ma'am. I am just leaving my mobile number to all of you.
हाँ जी sir. एक्चुअल में क्लास लिया है तो जो भी मन में कंफ्यूजन है उसको क्लियर करना बहुत जरूरी है ना।
यस हेलो इन सो फार एज 1 मिनट सो फार एज टाइम नॉट पीरियड इज कंसर्न
हां जी
द टाइम नॉट पीरियड हैज टू बी रेटिफाइड बाय द कॉम्पिटेंट अथॉरिटी एज लाइक ड्यूटी सो द टाइम नॉट पीरियड हैज टू बी रेगुलराइज्ड बाय द अथॉरिटी सो दैट इट शुड नॉट बी ट्रीटेड एज ब्रेक इन सर्विस. In your case, I am not so clear about the treatment of the first failure period and the second subsequent training period. Mm-hmm. But what I feel is that, like on a face of discussion, is that he has already joined and then been in a training, and he has been given an opportunity to reappear for the exam as per the railway rules. the rule is that unless there is a particular cap on how to treat this qualifying service, the treatment shall be from the first, joining of his first time training. So the training is also equally being to be included in counting that qualification. But yet we will clarify it.
जो डाउट तो है सर इसमें क्योंकि वो ब्रेक हो गया ना बीच में एक तरह से ब्रेक भी हुआ है
बट द ब्रेक इज नॉट ऑन द अकाउंट ऑफ दिस पर्सन अकाउंट इज ऑन द ब्रेक इज ऑन अकाउंट ऑफ द एडमिनिस्ट्रेटिव रिक्वायरमेंट
वेयर
यू कंडक्टेड द ट्रेनिंग इन अ पेस्ड मैनर आफ्टर सम पीरियड इट वाज नॉट ऑन द फॉल्ट ऑफ द एम्प्लॉय दैट इज व्हाई आई हैव अ डाउट आई वांट टू क्लेरिफाई विद सर
मेरे साथ ही एक कर्मचारी थे संजय शर्मा वो लास्ट ईयर एक्सपायर हुए कोविड से और वो अनमेरिड थे उनकी मदर को ऑलरेडी पेंशन उनके फादर की मिल रही थी और उनकी फैमिली में कोई और मेंबर नहीं है मदर चाहती है कि अपनी हस्बैंड वाली पेंशन को छोड़कर तो अपने बेटे की पेंशन ले तो क्या है पॉसिबल है सर ये
नो शी विल नॉट बी एंटेड गेटिंग कर रही नो द स्पाउस पेंशन शी विल बी गेटिंग दैट
ओके सर थैंक यू सर थैंक यू सर
सर वन सेकंड सर सेकेंडरी फैमिली पेंशन
ओके अच्छा सेकंडरी फैमिली पेंशन यू वांट टू एक्सप्लेन
जी सर जी सर
वन
सर
सेकंडरी फैमिली पेंशन इज बीइंग गिवन दोस डिपेंडेंट वेयर मदर और द फादर एज द केस मे बी हु इज अ फैमिली पेंशनर हैज आल्सो डाइड So at the time of death, say for example, I am a male railway employee. There are due to certain circumstances, there is a death happens. The wife of mine will become eligible unless and until she is not an employee herself and gaining, earning more than 9,000 rupees per month. So under such a conditions, my wife will be getting the pension. On my expiry, once she dies, the pensioner dies, then the kids, the children, if they are there, they would be entitled. Now, in that also, the son and daughters are there. If a son who has completed both the son or a daughter have not completed 25 years of age, not married, in case of both the people, then the person who has born first has to be given family pension, secondary family pension. In case if the eligible guy who is as per the date of birth writes in an affidavit that I do not want but you give it to my sister, then the railway authority can consider such an affidavit and then go for the dispersal of the family pension to the second person. In case if the guy has completed 25 years of age, he will become his eligibility will cease to become for the family pension, whereas the daughter will get. Even in case of the daughter also, if she is unmarried beyond 25 years, getting, or if married but widowed, or married but divorced. But both these occurrences has happened before the death of the family pensioner. Before the death of the family pensioner, if this incident has occurred, then the person of widowed daughter or the divorced daughter would get a family pension. For that, they need to submit all those documents, the death certificate of mother or father who was getting the family pension, and their supporting documents, wherein. The proper scrutiny will take place that she has become widowed or divorced just before before the date of the death of, or any time before the date of the death of the family pensioner or not. This is being so. This is the secondary family pensioner in case of them. In case there is a disabled child or disabled adopted child is there, then their eligibility will presuppose, or they will get a first priority than the widowed daughter or the divorced daughter. And once after dealing all these things, then comes the mother, widow mother, and the father. I mean, mother and the father. This is the sequence at which the second family pension is processed.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Sir, please explain the calculation of commutation, sir, once again.
Yes.
Sir, can I ask a question, sir?
Please. Please. Please go ahead.
Calculation of commutation.
Just a minute. Calculation of commutation. I'll just
Sir, 40% of pension into 8.194 into 12.
I have shared for all of the members. I have shared the pension related, rules related PPT. So you can, see that. 1 minute, let me share my screen.
Okay.
The commutation pension, you need to calculate. There are three factors in the calculation of the amount. One is the commutation factor, second is the factor of 12, and the third is your 40% of the, basic, 40% of pension. One. Yeah. Is it visible to you?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. The maximum year on which the factor is available for 60 is age or some 60. Yes, the factor is 8.194, and you see the pension which was arrived here for a net qualifying service of 33 years, the last basic including the grade pay, which means that is the 60 PC. Now you can correspond to the 70 PC, 72,100, and divided by 2 will become enhanced family pension, that is 36,050. Right? This 32,060. Will be brought here, and then 40% of the amount will be calculated. 40% of the amount is 14,420. Now 14,420 plus corresponding commutation factor of the employee and multiplied by 12. So this is the amount of arrival. One would get around 14,17,000 towards the commutation. Now in case of like medically decategorized, that is called as invalid pension, this factor will differ. It will not be a direct correlation between the age and the factors. The medical authority, while reviewing the employee at the time of total incapacitation or that certification when it comes, they have to categorically bring the age at which he is retired. For invalid purposes. Most of the time that he may be like 54, but his certification, medical certification will become like 50 or 48 or 49, depending on the medical decategorization. So that also will be placed on when you calculate the CPI.
Sir, one thing.
Yes.
Sir, commutation is not compulsory. Sir, employee may come out or may not be come out.
It is it is up to the employee to choose or not to choose. Some employee would think that, let me commute my amount so that some lump sum amount will come to meet out his exigencies. You know that when the PPO is made, we do clearly make that commutation amount, how much of the amount it needs to be deducted from the.
we may commit 1% to 40%, no, sir. It is our option, I think.
It is option, yes.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, up to. When you see the iPass, the screen charts, it will clearly shown that under the commutation, it is asked us whether the employee has survived commutation, yes or no.
Okay,
yes, sir. Please share PPT in the chat box, sir, because
I have already shared, Nageshwar.
Sir, it is opened in the system, so it will not download, sir. So please close the PPT in the system.
Okay. I got it.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
So what is a gratuity?
The gratuity is an sum of amount which someone is entitled on completion of certain years. I said that gratuity is like normal gratuity, death gratuity, and you have a service gratuity as well.
Sir.
Yes. Yes, please. Please go ahead.
One question. After 55 years, there is no entitlement for CGIS, what?
CGIS?
Yeah.
I think CGIS is stopped. I'm not exactly remembering. That is stopped well before terms of months or 1 or 2 years. I'll come back now. Be clear.
Because I am, my CGI is not deducted for from January. When I asked pay clerk, no, she replied, yeah, automatically it got stopped because not eligible after 55. So I just want to confirm that.
Whether my presentation deals everything about it, CGIS. It was there, CGIS, any other question? Meantime?
Yes, sir. A question.
Sir, I got a question, sir, regarding an enhanced family pension.
Okay. Level.
Sir?
Yeah, please go ahead.
कि यदि किसी एम्प्लॉई 50 साल में एक्सपायर हो गया सर तो उसकी इनहेंस फैमिली पेंशन कब तक मिलेगा
फॉर द स्पाउस
जी स्पाउस को
10 इयर्स फ्रॉम द डेट ऑफ डेथ ऑफ द एम्प्लॉई
ओके इसमें 7 ईयर 67 इयर्स नहीं लागू होगा सर
दैट इज फॉर द यू नो दैट इज फॉर द एम्प्लॉई हु हैज रिटायर्ड एंड सब्सिक्वेंटली ही कैन क्लेम अप टिल 7 years or 67 years, whichever is earlier.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Sir, एक question था sir. मैं पूछूं क्या?
Yes, please.
Sir, मेरा एक question था. मेरे पास एक employee है sir. उसके पिताजी का death 84 में हुआ था, 84 में. उसके बाद 2004, 84 में death हुआ, उसकी माता को job लगा. उसके 2004 में उसकी माता को expire कर गए, तब उसके बेटे को job लगा. अब क्या है कि 2020 में कोविड के कारण वो मर गया था तो क्या उसके बेटे को जॉब लगेगी अनुकंपा के आधार पर
द सन इज समवेयर एम्प्लॉयड ऑलरेडी
यस सर और ही इज नॉट कोविड से मर गया
नो ही विल नॉट गेट अनलेस एंड अनटिल देयर इज अ रिवर्सल इन द पॉलिसी ही विल नॉट गेट बिकॉज़ ही वाज ऑलरेडी एम्प्लॉयड समवेयर एल्स
यस ओके सर थैंक यू सर
थैंक यू एनीथिंग एल्स
Sir, I was asking a question.
Yes.
So it is just regarding enhanced family pension. So just if a person retires at the age of 55 and subsequently expires. And
retires on which count?
At the age of 55.
If I retired on which count?
Voluntary retirement.
Okay.
And he subsequently expires after a couple of years. Say around 57 he expires.
Okay.
And his enhanced family pension will be paid to a spouse up to 7 years or till age of 67, sir?
No, up to 7 years.
Only up to 7 years, sir?
7 years.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Anything
else? Any more questions, please, from the participants? Okay, sir. Shall we end the session?
Sure. Thank you so much. I think I hope that something was useful in this presentation.
Definitely, sir. On behalf of Sitara, I thank the Rajpurai sir, Deputy CAO, General South Central Railway Secunderabad, for patiently explaining all the doubts of the participants and also quoting the relevant railway board rules and numbers, making the position very clear to all the participants. Also, one small announcement on the session restart on Monday. The topic for Monday will be NPS. Again, we will have the Rajpurai sir, who is an expert on NPS, and he will be guiding all the participants, clarifying their doubts. Thank you.
I am not an expert in NPS, but I am interested in NPS. Naturally, there's attraction towards NPS rules.
Sir, please share the PPT, sir.
Regular interaction on the...
Nagesh, I just see that in the chat box, I have already uploaded, which I am able to see.
Yeah, but if it is open in your system, it will not download, sir.
Okay, now you try, I have closed it, now you try.
Yeah, please again, reshare, sir. I'll
try. 1 minute, huh?
So your number, sir?
My number is 97. I have already kept it in the chat box. 970.
No, it's not. 97?
970.
Hmm.
1370.
Hmm.
107. Just a minute.
Thank you.
Nayeshwara, once again I'll try to share.
Yes, sir, it is okay now.
Fine, it is downloading.
Yes, sir.
It's downloaded. Downloaded, sir. No problem. Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir, downloaded.
Okay.
Again, we uploaded. No problem. Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot. All of you. Stay safe.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.